Inflation in the Philippines again in an uptrend amid elevated prices of food, particularly rice. And with the El Nino phenomenon raising the risks, when can inflation sustainably settle within government's 2-4% target range? Let's ask our first guest for his insight. We're now joined by Nicolas Mapa of ING Bank. So first off, can I ask you for your reaction to the March inflation print? I mean, how does that compare to your forecast? Were there pleasant and unpleasant surprises?
Yeah, well, you know, I was slightly higher, 3.8%, actual 3.7. This needs to be a supply side issue. You have rice prices at 24.4%. And then you have, I guess, the transport, private transport also seeing a pickup in inflation. So yeah, overall was sort of expected given the supply conditions. I think if you look at the rice supply on shore, it's really tight, right? It's below the monthly average. I think it's like 2,200 metric tons that we usually have. Yeah, we don't have that. We have like 1,900. So, yeah, whenever you have, you know, shortage of rice, you have inflation at 24-25%. And that's always going to push up your headline number.
Are you still seeing second round effects in terms of inflation?
Not really. What we're seeing is actually personal services seeing a moderation in inflation. There was a bit of a pickup in restaurant inflation. I'll have to see the breakdown if it's more in restaurants or more in hotels. But I'd say, you know, maybe not just yet, but you know, if rice prices stay at these levels and energy prices stay at these levels, then we might eventually start to see those second round effects kick in.
You know, the Philippine government recently reduced its growth forecast for this year to 6-7% from 6.5-7.5%. Is this largely due to inflation?
No, I think this is everything. The way I look at the growth outlook was this year is very similar to how I looked at it last year. So you have the growth accounting C plus I plus G, and everything is sort of under siege. I wouldn't say under siege, but you know, all of those three are threatened. Consumption is threatened by inflation, and then you have this, you know, capital formation remains quite subdued.
Because of inflation. Yeah,
that's something that we have to contend with. And then government spending, there's a lack of fiscal space. So I said it last year when people were, analysts were saying, oh, we can have growth at 6.3% or 6.5%. I was saying that's a really tough order given all the handicaps that we have. So I was a bit skeptical that we could hit our growth target last year, and we didn't. So this year, even with the lower growth forecast, I think Secretary of Finance called it the more realistic target of 6-7. I think even that's going to be a bit difficult to attain, given that all of the challenges that we saw last year are probably going to be faced. We're still facing them here this year.
Okay, so one of the reasons why rice prices are high is because of El Nino. Yeah, what do you think is the worst case scenario when it comes to the impact of El Nino on inflation?
I think we're right in the midst of it. We're supposed to see, the Department of Agriculture said that we're likely to see this El Nino wane this month in April. So hopefully there's some respite for all of us, as well as the agricultural sector. And hopefully if that really does fade, and we could see better conditions for harvesting, for planting, then maybe we can see a bit of a pickup in supply.
Aside from El Nino, what other factors do you think will, you know, potentially push up inflation?
Yeah, this is largely just a supply issue. So you have issues on imported energy. And those are usually the two reasons why we see inflation here anyways. So I'd say the recent flare up in the Middle East, that's also likely to cause some problems if this does linger. You know, we really need to find a way to, I guess, improve our supply chains, as well as our lower dependence on imported energy. We're still behind in many things, and that leaves us very susceptible to what happens in global markets.
With inflation still elevated, still trending up, do you think that the BSP will, you know, keep interest rates high, or is there a possibility that they could cut it soon?
First off, aside from the inflation developments onshore, I think we also have to keep an eye on where the Fed will be. Because even if inflation does fall here, I think it'll be very difficult for the BSP to be considering any rate reductions if the Fed isn't cutting. So I've always said that the BSP will cut policy rates ASAP, or as soon as the Fed does. So that's the only window I see them doing it. But if it stays high, my guess is that, you know, this governor has shown his very hawkish side. So I don't think he's going to be in any hurry to cut policy rates anytime soon. And that's fine if you want to use monetary policy as, I guess, a buffer against inflation expectations. But I mean, that comes with a cost. You know, when you keep rates high at restrictive levels, these are not normal levels, no matter, you know, what some people might be saying, but this is restrictive levels. And that has an impact on growth numbers. And we saw it last year. One of the reasons why we didn't hit our growth target was because capital formation was weak. Yeah, it comes at a cost. So I think we're going to have to sort of be aware of that. You know, whenever you use interest rates to fend off high inflation, it's going to come at the cost of growth momentum.
So I remember talking to you before, and you had mentioned that, of course, the Philippine interest rates have to be above US interest rates. But do you think that, you know, the gap needs to be, you know, at least 100 basis points, or can it be a little bit less?
I think 75. If you remember when we were at 75 last year, peso was actually the third or fourth best performing currency before the rate hike in October. I think the reasoning of why they did it was a bit, I still sort of have a difficult time wrapping my head around it. There was no pressure on the peso that time. I mean, if you remember the emergency rate hike of Medallia, a peso was under pressure then. And I think there was no choice but to carry out the emergency rate hike. But for the October rate hike in 2023, the peso was actually doing quite well. I think we can definitely handle a 75 basis point spread, maybe
yeah,
in
it's
an
good
era.
Enough, yeah.
Yeah, but it also depends on what's happening in the world. I mean, a 75 basis point rate differential when the Fed is hiking is probably not going to be enough. So, you know, it's not just the spread, the magnitude, or the how big the spread is. I think it also, you know, we have to take into account what else is happening. Is the Fed still hiking? Is the Fed sort of posturing for a pause and then a cut? I think all those things come into play as well.
So right now, inflation is up, but it's still within the 2 to 4% range. Yeah. So I'm curious, what do economists need to see to anchor their expectations and to be confident that, you know, inflation is no longer a threat? And, you know, again, what about consumers? What do they need to see for them to anchor their expectation that, okay, inflation is not a problem anymore?
Yeah, well, for the analyst side, I think a lot of us take our cue from the BSP. So if the BSP's inflation forecast points to inflation within target, then we adjust, right? If the BSP adjusts its inflation forecast, then we adjust our forecast as well. I think that's just normal for local analysts and foreign analysts like who cover the Philippines. That a lot of it is influenced by where the BSP sees inflation. I mean, we have our own models, we have our own forecasts, but I think there's a large part of us that would want to would take the BSP's forecast, into consideration. One very good example of that would be back in September last year, inflation expectations were anchored in the sense that BSP's forecasts pointed to inflation within target. And then in, I think, October, all of a sudden they said, oh no, inflation next year is going to be 4.5. And then you can quickly see how private sector analysts adjusted their forecasts to breach target as well. So I'd say there's a bit of a link, maybe not a direct link, But I think we are influenced by where the BSP sees inflation. Now, if you're talking consumers, they're very receptive to the headline number. So if they see headline inflation moving lower, I think that's what really drives their expectations of where inflation's going next year. There might be a bit of a lag because, I mean, they don't monitor prices every day like most analysts do. But I guess they see it every day because they're consumers. So they would, I'd say, react to where headline inflation is. So if you want to anchor inflation expectations of consumers, I think we have to do a hard take on getting headline inflation under control.
Okay, and lastly, can you give us a picture of how Philippine inflation compares to regional inflation?
Just like everybody else in the region, where everyone is seeing a bit of a uptick for it, and it's mostly food related. Same issues happening in Indonesia, India, Philippines. So yeah, I guess El Nino is something that the entire or this side of the world is experiencing. So that's definitely having an impact. So we are seeing an uptick in inflation, food related, and of course also energy related for other countries that also are reliant on imported energy. So we are experiencing this just like everybody else. But I think on top of that, we also have to try to prepare for ways that the Philippines can be less susceptible to these global developments.
Yeah, so are we better off or worse off compared to our regional peers in terms of inflation numbers?
Level. Well, I think we'd say maybe in the middle, maybe on the higher end. Inflation in Indonesia is still at about 3%.
Yeah, why are we in the more upper end of the range?
Well, A, we import a lot of rice. I think one of them, yeah, if it hasn't been said enough, rice is our major driver for inflation. In fact, of the 3.7% inflation, 2.2 comes from just rice. So it's really that I think is one of the major reasons why inflation here is the way it looks, because rice is expensive and we import a lot of it.
Okay, so with that, thank you very much for your thoughts on inflation, Nikki. Hopefully, we will see inflation going down soon after El
Yep.
Nino, which again, we're in the middle of it right now.